Hello, everybody, and greetings from beautiful Bali. Welcome to another episode of The Filter. You know, one of the great things about being in Bali is very interesting people roll through town, and I recently sat down with Matthew Slater. Matthew Slater is a complementary currency architect and founder of Community Forge, which is a gathering place for communities that are trying to form complementary currency systems. Now, you might be asking yourself, what is a complementary currency? Is that Bitcoin? No, it's not Bitcoin. These systems predate Bitcoin. There are communities all over the world that have been trying to solve their local economic woes through the use of complementary currency, which is basically anything from a time bank to a LET system. I'll put some links in the show notes so you can do some research on yourself by yourself. But anyway, Matthew is at the center of this field. And like I said, it predates the whole Bitcoin phenomenon. And, you know, being that we're trying to create a Bitcoin economy here in Bali, I thought it might be interesting to get some perspective from someone who's been doing it for a long time. Now, it's an interesting interview because Matthew is not necessarily a Bitcoin guy. In fact, he seems to think that, you know, Bitcoin is just another version of the, you know, the poor money systems, the fiat systems that we've got in place already. So it's an interesting conversation. I hope you guys enjoy it. With that, I'll just let it roll. Enjoy.
How did you begin?
How did I begin?
Yes, how did you begin?
Well, it was an did I begin what?
This whole odyssey of yours. Predates Bitcoin, so that's why it's...
I saw that the LETs in my local town, Cambridge in England...
LETs is
the local exchange trading system.
Okay, so let's define a LETs system for those who don't know. What is LETs? I mean, we named it, but what is it actually doing?
A LETS is, I think of it as a community tool, and that's a way that people in a group can use each other's services because they're all listed in a directory and they can pay each other for those services, not using money but using their own credit. So you need no money to start up a LETS.
Right. You don't need any money at all. People are extending credit to each other.
Yeah, it's like I write you a check or an IOU, and the IOU might go around the system and then come back to me where I'll redeem it when I do something for somebody else.
Okay. And is there, are you counting units in this system, or is it just I did you a favor, so you owe the system a favor?
Most of the LETs do have a unit, and they usually make a pun on a local point of interest to make the unit. Like in Brixton, they had bricks.
Uh-huh.
In Cambridge, they had cams.
Uh-huh.
And they'll measure the unit usually in terms of a period of time. So LETs in practice is a time-based currency. But they're not very strict about it because the emphasis in LETs is what we do for each other, what you might call the real economy.
Mm-hmm. Real things, real.
So yes. They are counting, and the idea is that at the end you would have given as much as you've taken. But the real value is in the fact that we're doing things together and for each other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that. I think that modern money systems have abstracted so much away that we've forgotten that we're helping each other and doing things for one another. And, you know, in the modern world, if you have enough money, you can make anybody do anything. And we've lost the sense of community around it.
But also, you can make anybody do anything, but you don't have to know who they are. You could be many steps removed from them, and you cannot care about them, and you can be
right.
Exploiting them,
yes,
very heavily.
Mm-hmm.
But because the money system is so global and so liquid, it enables us, in a way, everyone to be in their own bubble. And there's no sense that we are a group, we're economically codependent. We need to trust each other. And we need to come good on our promises.
Yes, yes.
In the global money system, it's in principle anonymous. And therefore, you can get away with whatever you can get away mm-hmm. with.
Yeah, I agree. I think that there's whatever backlash is happening now, whatever projects people are adopting, they're seeking to fix that aspect, I think. This is part of the thing that humanity is trying to remedy. Well,
a lot of the fixes are sort of patches after the fact, because the way I've just explained it, maybe not very thoroughly, it's built into the money system. And the fixes that people are trying to do are about regulation on top of the money system. They're not really changing the incentives.
Okay. So let's go back where you encountered these let's systems, which were working, right? They were working.
Oh, there are many.
There are many, and they work. It's a system that has worked in various communities around the world, and you wanted to bring your programming skills to bear to make it more efficient.
And more up-to-date and more appealing to young people and just more appropriate. It wasn't appropriate in 2004 when I started, even then, that these things were happening by checks and by snail mail and by photocopying.
Right. We can do better than that.
It was immediately apparent to me as a web developer that this should be all on a website. There should be community members with accounts on the website, and they update their profile, they update their offers a month, and they make their payments, and they check their accounts on the website.
Right, it begs for automation,
it
begs for modern tools.
It would make it so much easier, because they had committees and they were all spending all their time photocopying and checking the accounts, and they wouldn't balance, and then they were burning out, and they were paying salaries, you know, salaries in the local currency to the committee, and therefore taking resources and time out of that system. So the aim was to make it more efficient so that Let's would be a more viable community model going forward.
Okay, so that makes a lot of sense. You saw a system that you could apply some automation, some modern technology to make it better. And that was back in 2004.
Yes, and in fact, I wasn't the first, but at the time, I didn't check. I just went straight ahead and I coded something.
Uh-huh. And other people had done something similar in various places.
There have been a few. I tell a lie, I did check. I contacted Michael Linton, who's the guy whose name is on the Let's brand. And he didn't tell me about any of the other projects, but he had already moved on from Let's. He was talking about multiple currency systems, and he wanted me to build one of those with him. But my thinking was, nobody knows what a multiple currency system is for. I just want to focus on a single currency system, and then I can know it can actually be used.
Okay, that
so
makes
I
sense.
Did do some research, but I didn't even know at that time there'd been a system running for 3 years. It was building members based in South Africa, and they were already connecting all the systems together. And in many ways, I still haven't got that far.
Okay,
12 years later.
So, all right. To keep the storyline, we've got you back in 2004. You see the opportunity, and you start to build a system, and other people are building other systems in other parts of the world. And, you know, I know that your current status is you're a nomad, you travel all over the world, you interface with all of these various communities. Presumably, if you've built that system that you described that automates the Let's systems, but we've got multiple Let's systems, multiple communities, people all over the world that are doing their own thing. Mm-hmm. And so how, you know, we've got these little islands of success, and the question becomes, how do we build the connections between these communities? Is that...
That's the question we're still asking today, but not in 2004.
Okay.
I maybe jumped ahead when I said that.
Okay, so back to 2004. I mean, this predates all cryptocurrencies, Bitcoin.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I think they were thinking about the problem, but they hadn't, you know, nothing was on the scene that even came close to working inside of a community. So, you know, and presumably, you know, the Let's systems were already functional, operational in 2004. So the whole idea is quite old.
And also the
over 20
banks,
years old.
Coming from a separate tradition, there was time banking, which was much less about members of a community getting together, sort of grassroots, and a bit more about government and social services saying, here's a tool that we can use to help organize the poor to build community so they rely less on government services. There's a strong narrative in time banking anyway, and time banking accepted the money from the government in a way that the Let's never did.
So there were governments trying to empower people to provide goods and services for themselves through the time bank mechanism?
Without money and without tax, yes.
Really? That sounds very ungovernmental to me.
Well, these were social programs. Mm-hmm. And if you can empower people in those small things, then they're less of a burden to government.
I see.
So it's entirely consistent with wider philosophies.
I see. I find that fascinating because it seems to me that governments these days are looking for ways to entangle themselves with people's lives and people's systems and create, a presence, a governmental presence in the lives of the people.
Well, both stories are true because there's this other story about reduce government, make it smaller.
I think that's really fascinating, though, that there are examples where governments have adopted these programs, even promoted these programs, and also that they have realized some measure of success.
Well, in England, they ran it for about 10 years and then mostly just dropped it. A change of policy.
Okay, so the government changed their policy.
Mm-hmm.
And did that mean that the projects failed or stumbled?
The movement is still going, but it has to find other sources of funding now.
So why do these systems need funding? For administration?
I'm not sure that they do. But in particular with the time banking programs where you're dealing with vulnerable people, they do want to have an administrator in the middle to do the matching, to be responsible for putting people together.
You mean like matching, people providing services?
Matching with offers with once, yes.
Oh, so they want an administrator in the middle there.
They call it a paid broker, yeah. And there's a similar thing in the business barter systems, which we haven't touched on yet.
Mm-hmm.
Those systems are very centric in that the owner of the software or the person who leases the software, it becomes his or her responsibility to make the trades happen because they live off commission. So they sit in the middle trying to make matches.
Mm-hmm.
In the lets, that doesn't happen so much, and probably lets are slower because of it.
It's slow. There's more friction because there you don't have this administrator.
Yeah,
person.
People don't always remember to check the directory if they want something, or if they're offering something.
Right. So they just go through the traditional means, not realizing that they could use this system.
It's the same with Bitcoin. You sign people up to Bitcoin, and then they forget.
Yeah, that's true.
Difference is that with the lets and the time banking systems, they're more holistic. Because they're thinking in terms of the whole community, not just in terms of the payment system.
Mm-hmm. And they're thinking in terms of the needs and the wants and matching the needs and the wants.
Yeah.
And
that is the real wealth.
Right. But you also want to build a scalable system that delivers those things without middlemen and bottlenecks, right? Or some
sort
of.
That's what I'm thinking about now.
Yeah.
But efficiency is not the first priority of these community groups.
Hmm. Say a little bit more about that.
Well, many of them are not even thinking much about scalability. They're very happy as they are. A small group of people who do things for each other is a perfect model utopian dream of community. And they're not thinking, well, how can we scale this up to 1,000 people? It would lose its intimacy for them.
Okay, that's interesting.
And many of them are old activists.
Uh-huh.
Like from the 80s and 90s, when they had their energetic heyday. But now their lives are slower.
Okay. So I think the complementary currency systems that I've studied and read about are interested in this problem domain that you've described, where people are helping one another, they want to provide for one another, they want to create a sense of community and doing for one another and facilitating that trade is part of what binds the community together. And it works for things like haircuts, lawn mowing, massages, even maybe doctors or lawyers. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I haven't lived my life inside one of these systems.
Those but are exceptional when they participate.
Well, and there are presumably things that are outside of the community, like a mobile phone. A little community might not make their own mobile phone or their own automobile. And so there is this interface with the outside world. And Is that just a separate interface out of band with this system living alongside it, or do these things interact and interplay?
I'm not sure what you mean by interface. What we're talking about is building a little bubble of friends who do things for each other, and it changes nothing about the global economy on that scale. Maybe they save a bit of money. Mm-hmm. If you start thinking of it as a money system, and start putting it in opposition to the global money system, then yes, you need to think about an interface. You need to start thinking about exchange rates between the local unit of account and national money, and also how to connect with other local communities. Mm-hmm. It, by way of building a sort of parallel economy of people doing things for each other.
Right. So that makes sense to me. Where I try to, you know, I start to think about what this looks like, and I ask questions like, let's say that I'm providing something for my community, and I'm giving and trading this in this local currency, but part of my supply chain requires me to buy things outside.
So that's the interface.
Yeah.
The way it works is that, yes, you need dollars or your hard currency to buy those things, and you pass that cost on to your customer. But the value added, which is to say the value you add within your community, can be charged in community currency.
Okay, so I'm a mechanic. A car mechanic.
Yeah.
And I'm offering my services in this local currency.
Yeah.
But when I do an oil change, I need to buy oil outside the system.
So you bill for the oil at cost, presumably.
Ah, okay.
And then in a separate system, the customer will write you a check or record an IOU in the ledger that they pay you 1 hour.
So the oil purchase, because it was supplied from outside of this little economic system, gets mm-hmm. billed separately?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you could think of it as two economies, one sort of sitting on top of the other. Or you could think of it as two economies with the global economy. The goods and services of the global economy, of course, they flow through the local economy, but mm-hmm. we keep separate accounts for locally created value and globally created value.
Okay. And the incentive to participate in such a system, is it solely philosophical, or are there built-in incentive mechanisms for the participants to say, oh, you know, I want to push as much as I can through this LETS system and reduce the amount?
A lot of people join LETS systems as a way to get to know local people. So that's one incentive. And many of them don't understand the monetary ideas behind it at all. But when it comes to the business barter systems, they have a number of selling points. And there's a pitch. Mm-hmm. A major part of the pitch is that, first of all, it helps you move stock, because there are people in the network who can afford to buy your stock. Second, it gives you a source of liquidity, because the money is actually interest-free credit granted by members to you and by you to them as needed. So it can help with cash flow.
But
for small systems, the incentives don't go much beyond that.
Okay, so that, you know, some of the systems that I've read about, for example, the Weir system in Switzerland, kicks in or is more utilized when there's a kind of a global slowdown or quote unquote recession happens. Mm-hmm. They turn more to this other currency.
Yeah.
Is that an aspect of these LETS systems as well? Is there like a give and take?
It's been observed that LETS have been stronger during a recession, but maybe not for the same reasons that the VIA is stronger. The VIA is really, it's a large system. And because it's not scarce in the way that bank money is scarce, when bank money becomes more scarce, people move into the VIA for liquidity. In the LETS systems, everybody's actually feeling poorer during a recession, and some of them pick up on the idea that maybe they can save a bit of money with the LETS. That's the theory, anyway.
I see. Well, and also there's an aspect here that I think a lot of people don't appreciate, which is around community resiliency. And
that was a big part of my thinking after 2008, when I was convinced the whole global system, or at least the Western one, was going to collapse any minute. Mm-hmm. And back to my software, I was coding a Drupal distribution. And the idea was that every community could have its own Drupal site, which it could manage reasonably easily, even host locally if it wanted to, and that it wouldn't depend on me. And it would be open
decentralized
source, so they could modify it. Yeah, and I was just giving them away as fast as I could. So I co-founded an organization in Geneva, Community Forge, and we offered these Drupal sites to as many French-speaking lets as would have them.
Why French-speaking?
It was just the networks we were in. You know, I tried to offer them to England, but it still hasn't worked out. and there's a few else around the world.
Well, I can certainly get behind the motivation there, and I suspect that we will see the need arise for such systems in the future as well.
And much bigger systems. The idea that members of a community might keep account with one another only applies to one of the future possible disaster scenarios. In any scenario that involves the internet going down, you need a whole different kind of money system. You know, Bitcoin gets lost to that as well. Mm-hmm. So there are many precedents in history, of course, for different ways of doing money systems.
2008 happened, right? And crisis averted, or you know, wherever we are now. However, I'm thinking of recent history in Greece, where they had their own financial problems and had a single currency that became paralyzed through no fault of those, you know, all of the communities that suffered under that crisis. The day after the crisis, they still had all the cars, all the machines, but yet everything came to a grinding halt because the centralized monetary system stopped working. You couldn't get money out of the ATM, you couldn't pay your suppliers, you couldn't...
So you're talking about the day after the referendum?
Yes, the Greek referendum where they...
18 months ago.
That sounds about right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so then they imposed capital controls on the Greek banks. And since then, Greeks have only been able to withdraw, I think it's 300 euros per week maximum.
Right. And can't pay international suppliers, like the money can't leave the system.
Well, the money can leave the system because it's leaving all the time going to pay the interest repayments on the Greek debt.
Right.
The difficulty is that when Greece joined the euro, they lost their monetary sovereignty. And the same with every country that joined the euro. Mm-hmm. And as a slower economy in the eurozone, they became a net creditor against Germany and France, they became a net debtor against Germany and France, who became net creditors. And there's no system within the euro to get those euros back to Greece so that the international balance of trade can be balanced.
Yes. So suffice it to say that there was a big problem there. Mm-hmm. And if communities had a way to come together in the way that you're suggesting with your software and this vision that you have, that would be a lot less painful, right?
That's the idea. The scale that the lets are being used now wouldn't be very helpful, but the mechanism is very scalable, in my opinion. The mechanism of mutual credit.
Okay, so let's use our imagination for a second, and let's say 2008 happened. You were coding and giving away this software as quickly as you could.
In my dreams.
Right.
And it goes viral. And,
right.
Well, and every village in Greece downloads a copy.
Right. Imagine like 8 years later when this happened in Greece, they all have these systems.
Yeah.
Like, how does it look different?
Well, it doesn't help very much with the international balance of trade, but it does mean that they can get food on the table.
Right.
They can pay their domestic food growers. And of course, it means then that they need less euros for those domestic transactions. And so the euros become available for other things, like paying the debt, if they want to, or like paying international suppliers. But there's not actually a lot of euros available to do that. Mm-hmm. But it eases the pain for especially the poor people. And it enables them to create employment opportunities as long as they can afford the capital costs of creating jobs.
Right. That makes sense. So presumably the reason that they didn't all rush out and download these things or tackle this problem is a lack of understanding of the problem or the potential problem or the the extra effort needed to make these arrangements before a crisis occurs?
I think that was a large part, but there are probably also other barriers. I was in Greece this year, and there was a big step forward in that a lot of the local networks have been thinking about these things, started talking to each other. And they started talking to me as well. So Community Forage has about three sites running in Greece.
Three sites. Servicing. They're
experimenting with other technologies as well. The uptake isn't that fast. And I'm not there to know the reasons why.
Okay.
It could be a matter of scale. You know, one Drupal site or others like it don't present as a national solution. Mm-hmm. When Yanis Varoufakis was thinking, how can we make a parallel currency where it would be the government issuing the credit in the form of future tax receipts, he wasn't thinking about installing Drupal everywhere. He was hiring some guys to go and hack the treasury.
Right. Well, and this goes back to earlier part of our discussion where government thinks of solutions in terms of centralized control.
Well,
centralized
definitely. Solution. And especially Yanis Varoufakis, who's coming from a communist point of view, it's all about central control.
Right. Which is a mono solution, a centralized solution, a single point of failure solution. Mm-hmm. And this is the world we live in today, where every community around the world, every country has a centralized mechanism for cooperation around the real things they do and make for one another everywhere.
Being the money system.
Right. And so we see things like what recently happened in India, mm-hmm. where the central authority says, no more 1,000 rupiah note, no more 500 rupiah note, mm-hmm. and there's chaos, bedlam, mm-hmm. untold misery from that fiat decision. And
but we see the same story everywhere. The story of government is the story of the control of people and making the people vulnerable to the government's decisions. And I would argue that true libertarianism, if you're talking about increasing the level of personal liberty, comes in organizing ourselves in small, manageable communities.
I would agree with that.
This is somewhat counter to the cryptocurrency narrative, where it says that libertarianism is about having control of your own currency and having the freedom to spend in a payment system which cannot be blocked. Mm-hmm. Of course, that is an element of freedom, but it's perhaps not very evenly distributed. It's not equally accessible to all, partly because mm-hmm. of the digital divide, partly because you have to buy the Bitcoin with money, using the old money, before you have access to those freedoms.
I really, you know, this is a classic problem with cryptocurrencies, is the fair and equal distribution. It's a classic problem.
Well, it's also a social and philosophical problem. It's not with the cryptocurrencies, but just the very idea of what is fair. Who is included in the system we're calling fair?
Right. Well, in a certain sense, everything is fair because everything, we're all born and we breathe air. And we come into this world with more or fewer resources, and we grow up in a cultural milieu that gives us more or less opportunities in life. But all people have their own relative strengths and minuses, and it's very hard to reconcile all those things and come up with some central version of fair, right? And that, to me, just strengthens the attractiveness of a decentralized system. And these mutual credit systems that you've described and that I've only recently learned more about are really fascinating. I think that they can exist in harmony or in a complementary way to this cryptocurrency and Bitcoin phenomenon, but I love the idea that two people can extend credit to one another and cooperate in that way.
So they absolutely can exist in parallel. We need to understand when to use which. And so in money systems, there's the idea that you have an area that's governed, or an area that there's trust or social order, and the area outside of that. Mm-hmm. And you use credit within the area. because there's the possibility of enforcement, and there's the idea that everybody knows each other and that their destinies are intertwined. Outside of the area where you can't really enforce payment, or you don't know that you'll ever meet the person you're trading with again in order to settle the debt, then you want to use valuable currency, a commodity currency. Mm-hmm. And Bitcoin or gold are perfect for that, or in practice dollars as well. Mm-hmm. But let's not get into how what right. dollars really are.
Yeah, yeah.
But they function as an international currency. And so you get them and you pay for things outside of your community, and then the transaction is finished and there's no more relationship. Mm-hmm. But within the community, you have this ongoing relationship because the credit's always moving around. You know, I talked about getting back to zero in the end, but in practice that never happens. And so
but you don't get too far from zero.
You don't get too far from zero because you've got to get back. The community has to be confident that you can get back to zero, and that's your credit limit or mm-hmm. your debit limit.
Yeah.
Because it works on both sides. Yeah, so you never get back to zero, and within the communities there's this ongoing web of relationships and micro debts and little bits of uncertainty about who owes who in the end, which bind everybody together.
Yes.
Also the non-monetary parts of the debt. You know, so if you do something for me, I give you an hour, there's a residual gratitude which is not captured in the payment.
Yes.
And that helps bind the community together as well.
Right. This is the thing that I think we've lost and are looking for again, is the cohesiveness and the feeling that we are helping one another and doing for one another, and those things bind us together as a community.
And make us happier.
Yes.
I'm sure there are lots of studies out there that say exactly that.
Now, getting back to you said that people need to understand. You made that statement, and I think you're right. But a lot of people aren't motivated to understand. Like, they just want to live their life. They want to, you know, go have their coffee. They want to go have their massage. They don't normally think like, okay, I'm going to make a transaction. Do I want to use the global money system, or do I want to use the local money system? And if there's any friction at all, they tend to make choices that maybe aren't good in the long run or good for everybody. Or how do you get around that dynamic?
Well, I'm doing as much work as I can educating. I co-authored with my friend, Professor Jen Bendel, the Money and Society MOOC, which is 16 to 20 hours over the course of a month, and it runs twice a year. And so we're educating quite a lot of people. Over 300 people have finished that course over the last 2 years, encouraging them to go much deeper into understanding what money is. But that kind of education, I don't know if it really changes people's purchasing behavior. I don't know if it drives them towards joining Alets, but it does help increase their consciousness. It's mm-hmm. it's a step. There needs to be much more investment, whether in money or in people's time, in making local money systems much easier to use. For example, there's lots of apps, for example, to help you pay with cryptocurrencies, but almost nothing to help you pay in mutual credit currencies. Mm-hmm. The banking system, or the global money system, has a big advantage there because it has access to unlimited investment money to help make payments convenient. And we see now, not only is it all about contactless payments and easy apps and, you know, online payments a few years ago, but they're moving now into cashless transactions, which is wave your phone or
yes.
show your iris or something. Mm-hmm. And the idea is that this is so cheap and easy and quick and convenient to pay that you never have to think about money. And within the complementary currency movement, it's very difficult to compete against that ease of use. So this is a big issue.
Yes, I agree. There are the social circumstances, the cultural aspects, the adoption. A lot of these concepts don't work unless there's adoption and cooperation. And I think one of the reasons that Bitcoin has succeeded is they've nailed the incentive mechanisms for participation, so the system at large has incentives in place that drive behavior without without someone saying, well, you should do the right thing, or you don't understand what's going
on. Can you clarify which incentives you mean and what kind of participation you mean? Because what I see is an incentive for people to do mining.
Uh-huh.
And that's all.
Right, which is something that's necessary for the system to work.
For that system to work.
Right, right. Yeah, and this is one of the reasons that Bitcoin exists and works. Bitcoin's got its problems. I think those need to be explored, and I think we need to think critically about Bitcoin. But one of the reasons that it has grabbed the imagination and the attention of a regular person is because the incentives were in place to make the system occur, right? And
I saw was a lot of attention being thrown at Bitcoin when the price went up.
Yes.
When we had
a small
clique of cryptocurrency experts who'd all got a few Bitcoin to play with, and the word started to get out. And suddenly, you know, by the time Bitcoin was up to $8, some of these people were very rich. And it just went up and up from there. And so, you know, building up media attention, like a classic bubble. The bigger it gets, the bigger it gets. And so Bitcoin launched itself upon the world on the basis of this rather dubious value proposition that if you buy it, the price will go up.
Mm-hmm.
Which is absolutely counter to what a money is supposed to do.
I agree.
One of the functions of one of the properties of a well-functioning money system is that the price be stable. And Bitcoin became popular on the basis of its volatility.
And it will be positive forever. Positive
volatility, but it can be negative.
Right.
And it will be forever interesting because of the price volatility, because it attracts speculators, because it attracts these narratives about you can get rich off it. And its very nature as a commodity, that's a very difficult term, we can go into it if you want, but its nature as a commodity makes it unsuitable for a really libertarian currency, in my view, where I define libertarian as increasing everyone's personal freedom. And if it's a commodity, it can only increase the personal freedom of the people who can afford it.
Mm-hmm. Well, although if we could start extending credit to one another in terms of Bitcoin, we could create our own Bitcoin. If I extend you Bitcoin credit and you pay me back in goods and services, and we never actually touch the actual blockchain.
So you could use Bitcoin as a unit of account.
Right, but it's got to get to that place where it's not volatile. Like, I agree with you that the high volatility reduces its utility as money, but it could play a role if it ever gets to that place where it's mm-hmm. less volatile than, say, the US dollar, for example. It could serve as a unit of account, and then we could start using that unit of account as our accounting mechanism for extending mutual credit.
It's not a future scenario I'm particularly looking towards, partly because it seems unlikely, given the volume of trade, that Bitcoin would ever be less volatile than the dollar. But also, when a community comes together and decides that it needs a unit of account, there are many things it can settle on. Most of them we see in practice are settling on time, but that's only for interpersonal services mostly, or you know, pots of jam and things.
Mm-hmm.
There are reasons why they might want another unit of account. Traditionally, gold has been used, mm-hmm. Whatever weight of gold, or silver a lot, or a weight of an actual commodity that you know the value of. So you could use a ton of corn as a unit of account. And that would be relevant because you know how to repay the debt. You don't actually, you can repay the debt with a Bitcoin, but what's somebody going to do with a Bitcoin? It's nice if the commodity backing is actually useful as well. A ton mm-hmm. of corn, it's not completely practical because it goes off. But, you know,
it goes off, and, you know, if there's a drought, there's relatively less of it, or
The price goes up.
Yeah.
So the price is stable, yes.
And with gold, you know, a gold meteor could arrive and double the supply.
yes,
in an instant.
Or could affect the price.
Yeah. And, you know, I have this theory that I'd love to explore with you a little bit, which is the whole unit of account question, where if you have a counting mechanism, a mechanism of counting that is static, then all of the real things that happen in the world can exist as a ratio to that static thing. Right, so that it says something. If the price of corn goes up, it means that there's a shortage of corn, and so we can take real world steps to rectify that real world situation.
In which case, according to free market theory, the price of corn is indicating the shortage and calling forth extra supply.
Yeah, yeah. Communicating to the community at large, mm-hmm. that, hey, this there's a real set of circumstances regarding corn. So we need to grow more, we need to plant more, we need to solve the drought problem.
But the only way you can have a stable unit of account is by disconnecting it from the commodity. Because commodity prices always go up or down. So we could define a unit of value called a Bitcoin, regardless of any Bitcoin trades going on and the Bitcoin prices. And that's what the dollar is, actually. And all the fiat currencies, it's a unit of value defined by the government, in theory. In practice, we then find, the unit of value is tied up with the actual commodity, which is imaginarily created, and then the price is affected. But in principle, the idea of fiat currency is that the government declares a value irrespective of anything else. They say this unit is good for paying this much debt. And so for most of history, the price of money has been fixed by fiat. It's one of the implications of fiat currency is that the price is determined, but this is no longer true because the unit of account has become bound up with the commodity nature, like a dollar is a thing, and therefore there's a supply and demand for the thing, and therefore the unit of account, the price of it goes up and down. This has been a very bad thing, in my view, in monetary history.
Yeah, I'm not very happy with our present monetary system, and I think there's all kinds of conflicts of interest when a single nation state is responsible for the unit of account for the entire world. There's some very perverse incentives there. Mm-hmm. And I think that's why things like Bitcoin arise. It's humanity's attempt to rectify that set of circumstances. Same thing with these LETS systems. It's an indictment of the status quo and a suggestion on something new to do. And, you know, people like you and I imagine these solutions and say, you know, what if these things were in place? Wouldn't life be better? Wouldn't we be happier? Wouldn't we be cooperating better? It's interesting that we're now living in a world where the old system seems to be cracking, failing, causing problems for people. Causing people to pay attention, right? Why do people come to your money and society MOOC? It's because they see there's a problem. Or why do people, you know, a lot of people get into Bitcoin because they think they'll get rich, but there's also an indictment of the old system, and they think Bitcoin might be a part of the solution, and that's why they jump in. For better or worse, whether it's greed-based or philosophical-based, I think we're quite lucky to live in a time where these old systems are starting to crack. Because there's a lot of, like I said, perverse incentives built into the old system, a lot of graft and corruption that the old system enables.
You say they're cracking and people are moving into new systems, but I'm seeing this and I'm watching very closely. It's happening very, very slowly. And it seems that we have collective trauma around the subject of money. Many people have psychological issues because
it's
scarce. And that makes it very difficult for us, firstly, to reimagine what money could be like, and secondly, to actually jump in and do something. So the education has to come first, I think. I don't think we're going to win the usability battle.
Well, that is the slow road, but I think it's the more... it's the more viable fix. The education needs to happen. And, you know,
and there's a very real fear that the current monetary order could collapse and it'll just be replaced by another one. And that happens quite a lot in history. It's not like because the top-down system fails, all that's left is bottom-up systems. No, they'll bring in another top-down system. It'll be based on interest-paying pretend commodity debt, as just as the current one is, because that's what empowers them. But they'll reboot it with a new story. New story be, it's different this time.
Yes, yes. Well, in fact, this is actually how political change happens. In many instances,
stasis.
Right, there's some sort, and this is what I think, I take inspiration from the fact that an economic problem is on the horizon, and when that happens, there's going to be, you know, a cashless society solution that the government suggests, or a negative interest rate solution that they suggest, mm-hmm. or a special drawing rights.
See the plot of Mr. Robot. in that, the money system is taken down by hackers, and then the biggest corporation in America releases e-coin, evil coin, and it looks like that was kind of the plan all along. So they've completely taken the government out of the money issuing equation, and now it's all a cryptocurrency issued by a massive corporation. Mm-hmm. I'm looking forward to series three.
Well, you know, thank God for Mr. Robot making this point, and perhaps it now exists in the public consciousness a little bit more than mm-hmm. it was before. And I think a lot of times that's the purpose of art. You know, they say art imitates life or life imitates art. And yeah, if you can, sometimes the best way to deliver a message is in an entertaining way.
I do wonder though about Mr. Robot, because for all the hackers in the program and all the revolutionary speak, there's not one word of criticism against Facebook or Google. And that's uh-huh. totally unrealistic.
Well, don't you think the evil corporation is like some approximation of Facebook/Google? Or
the evil corp in Mr. Robot is a mega financial institution.
So it's more like a Wall Street, like Goldman Sachs or something?
I think it's bigger than Goldman Sachs. Mm. They wanted to have one organization for the purposes of the narrative that could bring down the whole economy.
Right.
So, it's doing Wall Street trading, it's doing international stuff, and it's doing life insurance and mortgages and all of those things.
Well, you know, it's funny that you bring up Facebook and Google and so on, because in my opinion, they have the same frailties around things like information and information sharing that the monetary system happens. And there's all this talk today about the attention economy, and referring to places like Twitter and Google and Facebook and Instagram as ghettos of information or monoculture information distribution mechanisms. And you can draw a parallel between the frailties of a centralized monetary system and the frailties of a centralized information dispersion system.
If you want to make arguments about decentralization as an ethic, yes, of course you can. But let's not completely trash centralization. It has
its
times to be centralized.
Let's not be dogmatic.
To be decentralized.
Let's not be dogmatic about decentralization.
Mm-hmm.
There's some measure of centralization, and you know, an orchestra is centralized. There's a conductor, and you get beautiful music from an orchestra. If they all played their own mm-hmm. whatever they want to play, it would be a cacophony of unpleasant noise. So there's one example of centralization that is beneficial. So we can say that mm-hmm. there's some healthy version of centralization and decentralization applied to all human problems.
Levels of decentralization.
Right, right. And, you know, arguably, I think decentralized solutions take longer. Like, nature itself is decentralized.
Yes,
and
but
look
it's
at how powerful
resilient.
Yeah, yeah.
And
it evolves much better. Right, it takes a long time, though.
So you know, Bernard Leotard, he's a currency expert, lifelong, and he talks about monocultures and the idea that if you have a forest that's got all the same kinds of trees, it's very easy just to wipe it out with one disease.
Yes.
And so there's, you know, there's maths, biological maths around that, looking at the relationship between efficiency and resilience. And he argues that the global money systems are optimized for efficiency. And that means a lot of centralized control, but it also means they just collapse periodically, regularly, from time to time. And he counts and he says that there's been, you know, 100 and whatever
financial collapses in the world since 1971. I don't know, look it up.
Yeah, well, you know, that's a good lens, I think, to look at it through is efficiency versus resiliency, right? And we arguably, we have gotten way too efficient. And along with all of that efficiency, we've also lost the personality of the things that we can do for one another. We're so efficient.
We've also lost the joy of work because now everybody is a cog in a corporate machine.
Yes.
And we want to get as much out of our work for as little work as possible because we hate working.
Yep.
So in a more resilient system, we might have much greater control over our livelihoods. We might enjoy it and the efficiency might not seem so important.
Right, right. Well, I think for me, the price of efficiency in our money system is captured in the idea of gift giving. And if we give the gift of money, it's almost crass, right? Mm-hmm. We've removed all of the personality that's the potential personality of a really nice customized gift. Like, I've given you something, I know you, I know your personality, I know what you like and might like, and I say, oh, you know, I think you would really enjoy this. Like, there's a opportunity of personality exchange and bonding.
Because some people, money might be the perfect thing.
Well, the thing is, and I'm speaking generally here, but if I were to just hand you an envelope and go, hey, buy yourself something nice.
Yeah.
For me, that encapsulates, like, all of the things that money robs us of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it totally whitewashes the ability of a personal, interpersonal bonding opportunity and chance,
mm-hmm.
where that money could have bought something where I could convey my appreciation of you or my understanding of you or understanding of our friendship, and robbed it of all of that and just given you a stack of cash and said, buy something nice. And the antiseptic nature of money, thinking about the exchange in that way, defines it for me. Like, I can see where money has robbed us of that in that particular instance.
There's a lot of sociological thinking on those lines about what does money do to our personalities, our social awareness and social bonding, things like that. Part of it's tied to the nature of money as debt. But also the idea of money as a commodity that's interchangeable for anything, or money as something which goes up in value, whereas almost everything else in the world goes down in value. They all influence how we approach money and how we relate to each other through money.
Yeah, can you think of any authors or books or scholarship in that area?
Charles Eisenstein recently.
Ah, okay. I've read some of his things. Sacred Economics.
Sacred Economics are really good.
Mm-hmm.
But that goes back right to there's a German sociological book. You can put it in the link. I've forgotten the name of the author.
Okay. Yeah, we'll put it in the
classic.
Yeah. Well, I think these things deserve our attention, and I think you can just. It just rings true that money affects our sociology and our culture and how we interoperate with one another. And you can see it in a single exchange. You know, if you walk into a, you know, you have someone shine your shoes for money, and you have no obligation to be to have any interpersonal exchange with that person at all. In fact, you could yell and scream at them,
mm-hmm.
and not be nice to them at all because you've.
Because they need the money.
Right, because they need the money, and you've got the money, and so therefore you don't have to be nice in the slightest.
Mm-hmm.
You can just... yeah,
you're pure commercial transaction.
Exactly, yeah. And I think, well, getting back to our original topic, which are these let's systems and these community-building complementary currencies, is an attempt to bring some of that personality back to our interpersonal exchanges, right?
Well, and in doing that, to rebuild our lost communities.
Yes.
And that's the reality, not the money.
Right.
There's this idea going around that money is neutral, and it kind of is neutral, but there are all kinds of other biases in it which we don't see. Like when we use money, what is it that we're not using that we've lost?
Mm-hmm.
That's a bias inherent in money.
Well, you know, Eisenstein makes the point in his book that we're, because of the nature of the money system, we have to go, we are motivated to go find something that used to be free and charge for it.
Economic growth.
Yeah, for the sake of the all-important GDP or this infinite growth ethos that we seem to have. And I think it's undeniable that you can come up with your own causes, your own ideas about what has caused this, but it's undeniable that our communities, our family structures, our communities have become, I don't know, nebulous, not nearly as grounded, not, there's something missing in our community systems that people are seeking. They're seeking to solve that problem. More so in the LETS systems than maybe in the cryptocurrency and Bitcoin systems. I don't think that would rank near the top of the list of motivations for people in the cryptocurrency world.
Well, the LETS systems are community systems, and the cryptocurrencies are mostly just payment systems.
It's a new thing, so it's hard to apply old metaphors to these new things, because I think it's a payment system, a monetary system, a unit of account, attempting to be a store of value. It's like this, it's still being defined. And but I do think, and I agree with you, that it's not addressing the problems that maybe we need as a society to address.
I see that Bitcoin's attempting to address the problem of over-centralized monetary policy, including the problem of banks issuing too much credit.
Yes.
But there are wider social issues around money that it just doesn't touch.
I agree with that. And so the question then becomes, how do we make, but basically present that to the population of people out there and garner interest in this topic and try and foster some of these solutions? Because the solutions require mass adoption or cooperation. So you are selling a solution and asking people to buy into something new. And
well, the usual approach is to identify niches in the economy, sometimes niches which are not being served very well by money. For example, in a recession, a community in a recession has no money. So then you can come to them and say, look, well, here's a system where at least you can pay each other to do things for each other. Mm-hmm. And then you can have a whole group of people adopting the system.
And, you know, I think there's more of a chance of these things arriving in a crisis. These LETS systems, this Drupal system that you've built, can land in the middle of a crisis and immediately allow people to start cooperating. And this is something that we observed when the Greek crisis happened, to invoke that example again. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people were saying, well, if they just would have had Bitcoin, they wouldn't even have to worry about the euro and what the deal that Tsipras is making with the ECB, et cetera, et cetera. If they just had Bitcoin, it would have solved the problem. But it doesn't solve the problem after the fact. And if they don't have Bitcoin to begin with, it doesn't matter that Bitcoin exists in the world, because they're stuck. They're in their situation. And if you gave them a way to, if you just said, here's a system where the baker can make bread and the shoemaker can, you know, do his thing, and you guys can start to provide for one another regardless of the broader monetary set of circumstances. You know, you can just install this on a server and then start doing favors for one another. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty, well, it seems plausible to me that could happen. And so if you do buy into this notion that there's going to be an economic crisis on the horizon, mm-hmm. at some point there will be, you know, we
yeah,
think it's
you
gonna
want
happen
these
sooner,
systems on standby
sooner or later. Yes,
because we need to understand better how to run them as well. They do have a very high failure rate because of failures of governments or failure to understand what the credit in the system is actually doing and how it works. So it's not just a matter of downloading the software, it's a matter of creating that community structure which needs the software, and then understanding how to allocate credit within the system. And the system in Greece that got all the attention, the Volos TEM, started in 2011. They weren't using my system, but that's not the reason it didn't go so well.
they said to the local media, everyone in town can join our system and they'll get 200 euros free credit. And the newspaper reported, join the Volos Tem and get 200 euros.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody joined and they spent what they thought was their free money. And then the system was totally lopsided. All these people who thought they got something for free, but in the accounts they owed something back, weren't giving it, created a liquidity crisis in the local system.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even in this case because the people running the system didn't understand how it worked, but because the message was wrongly communicated, and then they didn't put those limits on in time.
Right, arguably it was rolled out improperly or, you know.
Anybody could have made that mistake.
Yeah. Well, I wonder how much people look at the existing body of knowledge in this area before they jump in to solve some new problem that arrives. I mean, you even mentioned that when you created your software, you just jumped right in, which I think people, when they see a problem, they want to fix it. I think that's a noble and honorable human, something that humans do, and that's good, but it'd be nice to leverage.
2009, that a friend told me, that financial crisis, they did it on purpose. And I went, what? How can that be true? And I looked into it and I watched Money Masters, The Money Masters by Bill Still.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the beginning of my journey into deeper understanding of the money system. Because I thought I was just building nice community let systems, little alternatives to money.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, it's a rabbit hole.
Right. Well, and if there's anything to learn from that, if there's another crisis on the horizon, there will be people with solutions ready to hand off.
Mm-hmm.
some with dubious intentions and others not so much. And I think, it'd be nice if some of these things that you're talking about are just as front and center when problems arise.
It would be very nice. Some of these mutual credit systems can be used to defraud people, or any money system, anything with credit and bad intentions, people are going to lose out.
Mm-hmm.
We saw this in Argentina in 2002. The dollar-backed currency collapsed because they couldn't make their repayments to Wall Street. Perfectly deliberate. And they resorted nationwide, it seems, to these local barter systems, which grew very quickly, and they started connecting to each other very quickly. But because these systems were so needed, questions about governance were not asked. And so it became very easy for some of those people running the system just to issue pieces of paper and sell them for money or for goods and services.
Seems to happen over and over again when human beings are involved.
It's called seigneurage in history. But mm-hmm. you want to be sure, first of all, that you have an alternative, and then secondly, that it's well-governed. Because with money systems, when they're badly governed, they can look like they're going very well, but mm-hmm. then everybody loses in the end.
So I know that this is your aim, to mm-hmm. build these systems that become adopted in this way and that help society in this way. It's a work in progress, right?
Always.
Yes. But you've been working on this system from at least 2004, right?
I started working in Drupal in 2008.
Oh, okay.
So I did another job for a while, mm-hmm. and then I came back to it in 2008 and said, right, I'm going to do this full-time, and look, here's this fantastic, appropriate web development framework that means we can actually give systems to communities and they can run them and own them.
Okay. So what is in place today? Say the financial crisis happens tomorrow, what do we have at our disposal today in terms of solutions or...
In terms of mutual credit solutions?
Yes, like...
There's not a lot.
Is this system that you built, like, let's say the ATM stop working tomorrow and the financial system comes to a seizure?
So the most number of people using one of my systems is about 3,000. But you would want to build something different if you weren't just thinking about local communities. So, those systems are in place, anybody can download them. But let's get a team of developers on them and start thinking about the next thing, I would say.
Okay. Well, you know, in all likelihood, the financial crisis won't happen tomorrow. Mm-hmm. So, and there, what you're saying, though, is there is a foundation here. There's a starting point.
It's a philosophical foundation as much as a lump of code foundation.
Okay, so we've got a ways to go. I mean, this is part of what you're calling for, what you work on day to day, and also the help that you're trying to elicit from the world, the coding world, the financial world, the world of economists and bankers, and you know, everyone who's in the land of finance and money and exchange and community building, like
everybody.
Right. Everybody. All people.
I think I know how to build a parallel financial system from the bottom up, from the grassroots, based on the credit that we can all offer to each other.
Okay, now we're getting somewhere. Let's talk about that.
So I'm calling it the Credit Commons. There's a number of people around me who are supporting the idea, and we had an event in Bali the other day to discuss it. There's funding proposals going in to the European Union and one or two other places, and the result would be, apart from any education and public relations and communication that needs to be done, which is a lot, the result would be, I think, a blockchain mm-hmm. that would connect all the local systems together. Mm-hmm. And we're working with a very large network of community currencies already called Community Exchange Systems, or CES, which is based in South Africa. And they have several hundred local groups who can trade amongst each other, mm-hmm. not because they live on the same web server and they can write to each other's databases, but through a web API. Through a thing called Clearing Central.
And not a blockchain, just a...
It's not a blockchain,
just a database.
And so I'm looking to upgrade Clearing Central to make it something really scalable and that anyone can participate in. What you called a clearing layer. So you do the local credit clearing in your local system and you get privacy through mm-hmm. that. But then if you want to trade with another system, you can create many clearing layers on this blockchain that I envisage called Clearing. It's called the Credit Commons.
Yes, I love this idea, and it is a decentralized approach, would allow individual communities to set up their own systems that work for them, but also plug into a broader credit commons, you call it, mm-hmm. to cooperate, right?
And it's pushing the credit creation power to the edge of the network.
Yes.
And the political power, because credit creation power is political power.
I believe in that series of videos that Bill Still put out that you mentioned. They talk about fractional reserve banking and money creation through credit, and the nature of that system today is done through banks. And it is an intriguing idea that I could offer credit to you, you could offer credit to me, and we could create the money that we need together as a community to facilitate trade and facilitate cooperation. As a byproduct of doing that, we're mm-hmm. happier, more cooperative, have more of a sense of purpose.
It's also another way of disintermediating the banks. Once you see that the bank's monopoly privilege on issuing currency is a form of us being forced to trust the bank.
Yes.
Then if we trust each other to issue credit, we're disintermediating the bank. And we're saving ourselves the interest costs as well.
Right. The interest accrues to the community, not the bank.
Right.
Right. Yeah, I love this idea. I think if the proper mechanisms are in place, and I know I have a technology background, you're a programmer as well, these solutions exist at the confluence of technology and people and society, so there's definitely a strong people aspect of it. Mm-hmm. But I do think that if the right technology was in place, and promoted appropriately, rolled out appropriately, that people could get behind this. You know, this could happen.
Well, I'm thinking of the Credit Commons as better than Bitcoin.
Yeah.
The proposition behind the Credit Commons is every bit as radical and interesting as Bitcoin, but the ability to make money by speculating on the unit of account is not there, sadly, mm-hmm. because this is sound money.
Uh-huh. Well, you know, I don't know. We can agree to disagree. I think Bitcoin probably plays a role here, and I don't know how useful it is to like pit one against the other. I think that they can coexist, but I think
for my purposes, many people understand Bitcoin, so I'm looking to piggyback off that and offer a critique of Bitcoin that says that we're missing something here. Bitcoin could have a place. It's a really great global system. It's got values in its anonymity, its ability to pay remotely outside the community, but we also need money within the community that we create ourselves.
Yeah. I think it's very useful to not be dogmatic about Bitcoin and to keep an open mind, recognize what Bitcoin can and can't do, and also think about these. A lot of the problem domain that we've discussed in this conversation are not even tried to be addressed by Bitcoin. So, and these things are necessary, I think, you know, they are problems that do exist and deserve people thinking about a solution to them.
So I sometimes contemplate the Bitcoin utopia, that society, if Bitcoin is envisaging a society, it's envisaging a money system. But, you know, if all the Bitcoin dreams came true, where would that leave us? How much better off would we really be?
Well, you know, it does solve certain societal problems. The problem domain is not as broad as the one you and I have painted in this conversation, but it could play a role, and it could take us on an incremental step.
And I do think it's a step forward.
Yeah. Yeah,
but not enough for me.
Yeah, I agree. It's not going to solve all of our problems. We've still got human beings involved and society involved, culture, and it's a piece of the puzzle, but not the utopia. Utopia is not going to arrive on the back of Bitcoin. It's going to take some other things. Well, that might be a good place to kind of put a bow on it. Although, maybe you can just tell us a little bit about the project, how people can learn more about the project, and if you want to say a little bit more about the kind of people you wish would get involved or the kind of help you need, that might also be interesting.
Well, there's a white paper at creditcommons.net in French and English and Spanish. I'm really struggling with the idea of how to involve other people at the moment, because volunteers are very difficult to manage, and you know, it takes time to induct them, and then you don't know if they're committed and things like that. But people are slowly coming along. The founder of CES is coming to Bali in February. We're going to have 2 weeks intense planning together. And anyone who's serious about developing some software, I encourage them to contact me, because there's plenty to do. But also, anybody who wants to find out more about this alternative views of money to the view propagated within the Bitcoin community, please do the Money and Society MOOC.
Okay.
And that's a great starting point.
And that's beginning again, I think, is it March in London?
Mid-February.
Mid-February in London.
It's a MOOC. It's online.
Oh, it's online. Okay, yeah. So you don't have to be in a certain place.
It's a prerequisite for a course in London in March, but the MOOC is free.
Okay,
and
fantastic.
And the course you pay for is optional.
And they can find the MOOC where?
Search Money and Society MOOC.
Okay, well, I'll make sure to get the URL into the show notes.
Right.
And there's the white paper, there's the MOOC, and you can be reached by email?
Yes. My website is matslatz.net.
Okay, all right. We'll put those in the show notes. I didn't mean to put you on the spot to come up with a bunch of URLs. We'll just put those in the show notes. That'll
be
fine. Thank you very much for sitting down with me.
It was good.
I think this is a very intriguing topic to discuss. Lots and lots of nuance, lots of things to explore. It's been a real treat to have you here in Bali and to sit down with you for a little while and explore some of these ideas. Thank you very much.
Thanks for all the attention.
You got it. We'll see you again in February, yeah? Okay. All right. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for listening, folks. If you'd like to learn more about what we're up to here in Bali, please join us every Tuesday night at Hubud, that's H-U-B-U-D, hubud.org for more info on that. And if you can't join us in person, we broadcast live on YouTube. The channel is called The Filter Live, all one word. My name is Gary Dykstra. You can follow me on Twitter at DykstraNet. And last but not least, we coordinate all of our activities on bitcoinsinbali.org. That's it. We'll see you next time, folks. Hope to see you again real soon.